We welcome you to another episode of Burn Tune Podcast. Today, we have here with us Rohan George Umesh, multi-instrumentalist from the city of Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu, India. He has been in the field of music teaching and performance for over a decade now, and particularly lives and breathes the piano and music production. Let's ask him on his views about music today. Hello, thank you. Good evening, Rohan, for joining us today for this session. And just for everybody's feedback, Rohan here is a proficient musician and who hails from Coimbatore. And he's been practically learning music since he was young. So we're going to be discussing a lot of fun stuff. And welcome, Rohan. Welcome. Thank How have you been? You. How are you doing?
Good. It's been great. Life has been good.
Okay, great. Cool. So Rohan, first of all, I want to ask you, what is it that you do as a musician? Like, what do you work with? Are you a singer? Are you a guitarist? Piano player? Tell us all about you.
Okay, so I think it's only fair that I start from when I started. So the starting was pretty unusual for me because both my parents, my mom and dad, both their families, they are musically inclined. So it was only natural that I would also get inclined, but the way I did it was quite weird. So I started off with ear music, which is normal. But again, from a family that hails from classical music at its roots, ear music was not really appreciated at the beginning.
What is ear music?
So just hearing and playing, imitating whatever you hear.
Got it. Okay.
Right. So I started when I was in the third standard. So I heard one of my dad's students play an examination piece, you know, when Trinity and Royal College started their centers in Coimbatore. So I started imitating whatever I heard, and then my dad stopped me. He caught me one day and was like, no, you know, that's not how you learn music. I'll teach you how. There's a way to learn music, so I'll teach you how to do it. So then he started on with notations, and he introduced me to classical music, you know, with basic music theory, you know, the crude theory. So for 1 year I was okay with it, but then I started to goof around. I didn't really want to practice, you know, everybody has a problem with that. You don't know how to practice, you just want to be able to play that well.
Yes. Then, did you just to stop you there for a second, I want to ask, did you like that experience? How was the experience for you to be taken away from, you know, absorbing music the way naturally it came to you, to being to go through these structured human constructs? How did that feel for you?
Okay, so back then, let's just say I wasn't matured enough to understand the difference. I didn't have any experience with what music was, how I took it personally, or what I perceived of it. None of that. I didn't even know a thing about music except for the melody or the tune that I heard. And I saw that as music. So there was nothing else. It was just the sounds that I heard. So when I look back at how I began, I wish I did have the sense to understand why I would need a solid foundation to begin with. And then I could explore my interests. I could try different things, try playing by ear or choose to follow notations. So I'd have to have a goal, because if not for that, then I don't think I would... It's like that saying, jack of all trades, master of none. I would just know bits and pieces here and there, but I wouldn't know how to properly execute any of it.
Got it.
I couldn't have called it a hobby as well, because I could make nothing of it, because it's just bits and pieces lying here and there.
Amazing stuff. You know, from the research that I have done, like, you know, your ability to absorb notes, to absorb melody, you know, I think so that's the beginning parts actually. And often in music school, when somebody doesn't even know how to do that, we start off with theory, we start off with basics, we start off with these structured A, B, C, D, E, F, G of language. But like, considering how we learn language, right?
Yeah.
We learn language naturally when our parents speak to us, and we make mistakes and parents don't say that's a mistake.
Right.
And slowly we just develop and we become proficient at it so well. Kind of like you're jamming with adults and they are not stopping us, right?
Right,
I mean, that's what was happening with you. But yes. The way that music as an institution, as an academy has structured, I think this is, I feel that this is taking away the joy. I mean, obviously, once you grow in it and you become the mature person that we are at 16, at 15, 14 years of age, that's when I think so, when you bring in the theory and all, things start falling into place naturally. It's not a burden.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, I think, yes, like the comparison of language is quite important. I think it's the most relatable thing that we could compare with, you know, how we learn music or begin to learn music. So initially as kids, we would start speaking from what we hear from our parents, and we might even get pretty good at it before going to a school to learn the alphabets first, and then, you know, learn to frame proper words.
Exactly.
And then you'll learn all the other, the vast majority of it. But with music, you know, I feel that if I'm just being open over here, so you begin with hearing music or recognizing a sound and then calling it music. I mean, I'm just talking from my personal experience, whatever I had gone through back then, before when I started initially. So I could only perceive sounds as music, right? So if I had explored that, if I didn't, so the thing is, I didn't, you know, before that my dad pulled me, but if I had, I don't think I'd be at a level where I could have been a better musician. Than to call myself a pianist, I would have to consider myself a better musician. So imagine this, you play the guitar, you're a guitarist. So what would be better if people come and tell you, hey, you're a good guitarist, I heard you play, you're a good guitarist? Or what if people say, hey, you're a really good musician? Which one do you think actually means a lot more to you?
I think being a musician definitely means a lot more. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's basically understanding a lot of what those sounds have, you know, whatever's behind them. It's not, we could reproduce all of that instantly, but then to understand what it is, trying to understand just how a language is, you understand why these words are, what these words are made up of, you know, stuff like that. So I had to get a detailed explanation of what those were, because if that guidance wasn't there, then I wouldn't be in a position in my music field where I am right now.
So how early did that guidance come to you, like at what age?
Oh, for me, I would say it's relatively late compared to the kids these days. For me, it was, as I said, third standard, so that would have been eight and a half years, which I think it would have been a bit too late. Comparing the kids of these days, they pick it up as soon as what, 3 years, 4 years, you know, they immediately show an attachment to music.
Yes.
So that's when, you know, we broaden our scope of teaching. You know, we try to bring up materials or try to bring up lessons that would address their needs at the age that they're in.
You know, or a skill level that they are in.
Yes, because you cannot go and explain theory lessons to a four-year-old.
Absolutely.
They will never, they cannot, it's impossible for them.
I even think you can't explain theory lessons to an 18-year-old if they don't have,
right,
the, you know what I mean, right? The preconceived information, yes, or like idea of how everything works,
yes,
right?
So
I think this is where, you know, what I am trying to do with something called Burntune, which is like a community. I don't know, you must have seen my WhatsApp
status,
right?
Yes, yes, yes.
So what we try to do is we try to create like a form of a clubhouse. I don't mean the app,
right,
like just a clubhouse where people are meeting, talking, trying out stuff. No one needs to be perfect, but it's just that environment that loops you in. And once you are in that environment, then the desire and the interest to learn the complicated, the more structured stuff comes in, right? So to understand why those notes work, why what rhythm is. It's not strumming patterns, it's actually rhythms, right?
Yes.
You and me know this very well. So yeah, so that's the kind of environment that we want to create for people that loops them into self-learning, right?
Right.
With proper guidance. I mean, considering online, we can give information, but the amount of load that student has to take that information in a Zoom call when they can simply go browse it.
Right, yes.
On the side, right? Mm-hmm. So, yeah, so I think the cultural aspect of it, you being born in a musical family, you got the cultural exposure to it.
Right.
Way yes. before yes. formations. And I think like for any new learner who doesn't know how to sing, doesn't know how to keep the beat, that's what's difficult.
Oh yeah.
Like, and many teachers, they go in directly, yeah, hai strumming, yeah, hai chords, why are we learning? Don't know how to do, we'll figure out. And it's just a very, I think you know students who've been with teachers who've had just a bad experience learning.
Oh yes, yes.
And just given up on it, right?
Yes, yes.
So yeah, so that's, what do you think about this idea of an inculcation pupa stage of like, I was even thinking, you know, regardless of age of 3 months, 4 months, you know, where they just get to try out stuff. They feel, we try to make them feel good doing music and not criticizing the part where you're doing wrong, you're singing incorrect, you're flat. What is flat? I live in flat number B18.
Yeah, that's the flat there.
Yeah, right?
Yes. So, as I was saying, you know, the beginning stage is always important because whatever you teach them or introduce to young learners, I'm not saying with regards to age specifically, I'm saying the based on the duration they have been in that musical environment. Okay, if they choose to learn an instrument or if they're getting interested in learning an instrument, that would be considered as the beginner stage, not, you know, how old you are. That has nothing to do with, you know, any of this.
Yes.
If they are at a very beginner stage or if they're at a young age or a young stage of learning music, it's always important that as teachers, we would have to come up with lessons or ideas that directly nurture their needs. Because I'm totally against this idea where you force any new learner to learn the structure first, because that would only be pointless. It would have no meaning initially. And by the time they get to, you know, when they want to become a pro musician, they would have already left the idea. They would have abandoned the idea of learning music and would have thought, okay, this is not what I want.
It's like all those German classes where they don't even show you one love song.
That's a good explanation. That's a good comparison.
Yeah, right? I think the emotion matters, right? I mean, even though like in a corporate world, we completely overlook emotion, I think the idea here is to sell the emotion. When you are able to get that engagement from that student, that's when you know, okay, this student themselves will want to pursue this, that need will develop, right?
Right, yes.
Perfect. Great. So Rohan, now my question is like, you know, as a musician yourself, as you do all your work, you consider yourself an artist, you write your songs, you do your performances, like what advice or tips would you give to other people who want to start learning, but they are in the mode, nahi, it's just a passion, it's just a hobby, you know, like many people just by saying that they're limiting themselves.
Right.
No one's telling you, okay, you will become Mr. Amit Trivedi or Hariharan, right? But yeah, what tip would you give them?
Okay, so I don't think that I'm still at a position where I could give tips, but I could give a few examples based on how I began. So I consider myself an introvert. I mean, now it may not be so true, but yes, at the beginning, an introvert musician, that is what I was, because again, the structure had a huge role to play in that, because I was only put in one box, as in one environment where I could expose myself as a musician. But whereas I should have been in more places to expose myself, not for any benefit, not out of any pressure, but of my own self-interest. So that is something that didn't happen, and then I had to force myself to get into that habit where I try to expose myself. I mean, yes, we do make mistakes in what we play. Of course, there will be. But, you know, I've been fortunate to have kind people who are not very judgmental, but they do give constructive criticism. So for any budding musician or a budding artist, the first thing that I would say is know your audience before you submit anything, before you put anything out. Because I would say there are chances where those negative comments or the negativity that you would get from some people might make you think twice, might make you think if this is necessary, should I have done it, is this something that I should pursue at all? Should I even take one more step after hearing what they just said? So I would ask you to first expose yourself to your closest friends and your closest family. I'm not even going to include relatives in this because that might really, you know, do some wrong. But again, closest family. So I was just fortunate enough to have relatives again who are into music. But my parents and I, we live in a different state. They're all in Kerala. We are in Tamil Nadu. We are in Coimbatore. So I didn't have them involved directly. But I do know that my parents have shared, you know, what I do. And I've heard their appreciation or their criticism about what I do. So the first thing would be to show your talent or to expose what your interests are to your closest friends and your closest family, because those are the ones who would actually tell you or help you have a clearer understanding, you know, if this is exactly what you want to hear or if this is exactly what you want to do, irrespective of it being a passion or a hobby or a full-time career out of it, you know. So friends and family, yes, closest, the most closest people that you trust, it's very important, because these days, that, you know, a lot of people have a lot of friends, but not all of them are true, you know. That's
absolutely
sad truth, you know. You can't do anything about it. That's become a natural way right now. So it's important that you only show to those people whom you trust first, because what they tell you could help you help bring clarity to what you want to do with that passion or that talent or that skill that you have. So that is something that I did not do. So only when I started teaching people, I understood all of this, you know, what I've missed out, so that they don't miss out on that.
That's an amazing thought.
That would be the number one thing I tell anybody who is stepping into, you know, music in general. The second thing would be, do not expect overnight success. That will never happen. That can never happen. Either it's going to be temporary or it will never happen. Because when learning music, let me put it in this way. When learning music, the golden rule is you would play incredible when you're playing it fast. Try playing that same thing slow. You wouldn't. The chances of you making a mistakes are high, very high, compared to when you're playing fast.
Totally.
So when I ask students about practicing or how they practice, they would tell me that they played fast, which is not what I expect them to do, because the process of going from slow to fast is what matters. The process of the practice is what will bring discipline, is what makes you a better musician. So even with the career itself or that passion, if I may, or that passion or a hobby, even if you're trying to develop either of these, you would have to take step by step. You cannot run because you would fall.
Yes.
There would be obstacles in between that you don't understand or that you would overlook, and you would trip on it and fall. So the process, start from slow to fast, because the process is really, really important in this. However slow you are starting, it doesn't matter, but keep it consistent. So slow to fast, always remember this. Go slow, then go fast.
Absolutely. You cannot run unless you know how to walk properly.
Yes, totally. Correct.
Amazing. Thank you, Rohan, so much. Thank you so much for coming for this call. I think this is going to be so much of value for all the people who do watch this content and, you know, take it away. And really, I'm looking to collaborate with you, your ideas, and, you know, bring this community to a bigger, larger level, particularly as we move to more of a digital medium, you know.
Yes.
Being human beings who have been given the gift of technology, you know, like all those engineers, thank you.
Yes,
right,
absolutely.
Now you're making it possible for musicians to survive, so.
Yes.
Right?
I'm honored, Daniel. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. This has been a really good conversation, you know. I'd love to do more about this, because the ideas and the thoughts that, you know, that come from both of us, you know, to exchange those, I would get to know a lot more, you know, from just this conversation. Because again, I started teaching only, say, 2 weeks. Officially, it's only been 2 weeks, but I've been an offline teacher for about 3-4 years.
Yes.
But it's only up until, you know, the first week of July that I decided, yes, I'm going to take music as a full-time thing, you know, not going to be part-time, it's not going to be a hobby.
Absolutely.
So, yes, it's interesting. It's very exciting. There's a lot of hard work, but you know, it's something that we love. So push it all the more.
Thank you so much, Rohan. Thank you so much. And for everyone who is watching this call, this is exactly what BurnTune is about, right? BurnTune is about creating this platform for you as a musician, for not only for you to teach or learn. I mean, that is definitely important, but to use that teaching and learning, just like in a Gurukula model, to make you the guru, to get you to, you know, have the, should I say, guts, you know, to be consistent. Like Rohan says, you know, it does take a lot of time. Don't expect overnight success, but you know, that is the beginning of your journey. And you know, this platform ensures that negativity and all that doesn't come across to stop you or hinder you from your creativity. Great. Thank you, Rohan. Catch you
always
soon.
Pleasure, yeah, man. Yes,
awesome.